Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The text for our meditation this morning is the gospel lesson read before, the gospel lesson appointed for the transfiguration of our Lord. First, however, allow me to please greet you from Concordia Theological Seminary in Fort Wayne, where I serve as president, to greet you on behalf of our faculty, our staff, and especially our students, a couple of whom you know, and one of our former ones being your pastor. It is our delight to partner with you in the formation of servants in Jesus Christ who teach the faithful, reach the lost, and care for all. It is a real pleasure to be here at Zion Shum, a congregation, a building by which I have driven many times on my way to Ohio State football games, but have never been inside. This is a real treat. And particularly on this day, on the day of the transfiguration of our Lord. For in celebrating this day, we get a glimpse, brief as it is, of our Lord's glory. Most of what we have recorded in the Gospels are accounts of him in his ministerial state, his servant posture, but for this one brief moment, we see a peek, if you will, of who he is as the majestic Son of God, the Word through whom all things are created and by whom all things are sustained. Even that breath you just took now, supported by our Lord Jesus Christ. The Greek word that makes up transfiguration is one that is perhaps, if I were to read it, you would hear the roots of the word metamorphosis in it. Transfiguration, a changing, a metamorphosis. Now, typically, we don't use that word all that often in our day-to-day lives. Maybe if we're doing a science experiment and we have a caterpillar that is metamorphosizing into a butterfly, we think of that. But most of the time, that's something we don't typically think about. And yet each of us goes through this every day of our lives. We don't realize it, we don't see it because it's a slow process, but we are changing. In my own case, I'll just put it like this. I'm not the man I once was. Now, maybe that sounds negative, but in some ways, it's actually a good thing. I'm not the man I once was, say, 25 years ago, when I was in my mid-20s. I was a little bit thinner then. I had a bit more hair. I was somewhat more energetic, you might say, but I was also far less wise than I am now. At least, I like to think so at the present time. We all change, we all grow, we all age, of course, and in the end, we all die. Here on the Mount of Transfiguration, you and I, along with the disciples, learn a little bit more about Jesus when we see him transform, metamorphosize, transfigured in a moment. Not a long, gradual process. But quickly, before their eyes, they see him for whom he actually is. And the point for them and for us is don't forget. Don't forget that this Jesus, who goes about in humility, who for the vast majority of his earthly life has on the form of a servant, is in fact God. God in man made manifest. He is the one who created all things. He is the one who sustains all things. He is God's Son, true God in the flesh, not just a prophet, not merely a lawgiver, but in fact, true God, begotten of the Father from all eternity, and true man, born of the Virgin Mary. This is Jesus. This is the one whom the disciples see plainly and clearly, and they are dazzled, and they are overwhelmed. What do you think of when you think about that moment on the Mount of Transfiguration? What do you think it looked like? I was struck this morning hearing this once more, having read this text so many, many times over the course of my life, but to hear that his clothes became radiant, intensely white, as no one on earth could bleach them. Intensely white, as no one on earth could bleach them. A week ago this morning, I preached in Monroe, Louisiana. A week ago this afternoon, I preached in Ruston, Louisiana. Typically, I forgot my alb as I was traveling down there, and so I had to call up my wife and have everybody at the seminary go through all sorts of shenanigans to put it in the overnight and send it down to me. And when it arrived before I actually arrived. I had another place I was at first. And here it comes. It comes out of the box. And the pastor who received it said, "That thing is a mess. Had a big coffee stain on it." What do? Have a coffee mug with you when you're preaching in the pulpit? Not usually. So he took it and he had it cleaned. It was that bad. Well, I got it, and I knew where the coffee stain was, and I can still see it, but I don't think you can from where you're sitting. We can't get those kinds of stains out. We can clean things up. We can make our whites whiter and our colors brighter, but we can't make them perfect. What this text is telling us here is that the disciples, Peter, James, and John, saw Jesus as he is in his absolute godly perfection, fully revealed to them in his majesty. Now I asked you, what does that look like? Well, maybe you looked at your bulletin cover, maybe you didn't, as you were coming into church this morning. Is this what you think it looks like? Is this what it is? There's Jesus sort of appearing in a haze, in a mist, and there's Elijah and Moses alongside of him. Maybe, maybe not. Each of us will conceive of that in probably a little bit different way in our own minds. But what this is trying to communicate is that they saw him as he truly is. And whether or not the picture does justice adequately to what was actually happening at that moment, this bulletin cover does get one thing absolutely right. And it's simply this. As miraculous as it was for Moses and Elijah to be there alongside of Jesus, in the end, the disciples saw what? Jesus only. Jesus only. That's the point of Transfiguration. That is the message of this day. Our Lord calls you and me back to see Jesus only, as the one who was, who is, and who is to come, and as the one who continues to love and to support you in every waking and sleeping moment of your life. Jesus only. That brings us to this place in the church year and why Transfiguration is celebrated where it is. Jesus, who was born for us on Christmas, Jesus, who grew up and was revealed to be the Son of God, the Christ, the Messiah, Jesus, who came to bring God's word of the gospel, Jesus, the light of the world that has been revealed to us throughout this Epiphany season, who has come to fulfill all that was spoken of him, who has come to fulfill everything written in the law and the prophets, as represented here by Moses and Elijah, everything that has been taught to us so far this church year is fulfilled in Jesus alone. Jesus only is the one who saves us and supports us. And this poises us, this prepares us for what comes later this week. We make the transition to Lent. Ash Wednesday is before us. When we turn once more toward Jerusalem, when we set our faces to the place of the cross, as we see Jesus now taking on his ministry in a concrete way on our behalf, bearing the sins of the world in his body, continuing to fulfill God's law in absolute perfection, and that leads him finally to the place of the cross, Golgotha, on Good Friday, where he fulfills all things and where he will cry out for you and for me, "It is finished." And we look forward then to the celebration of that day as our Alleluia's return Easter Sunday, because his sacrifice is fully accepted by God and you and I are declared justified, righteous, forgiven, God's own children. Which then brings us, of course, to the other side of this text, which is summarized especially by Peter, but also embraces James and John. I love Peter. He's a wonderful disciple. He always does the wrong thing. He makes me feel good about myself. When Peter is confronted by the reality of the transfiguration, he says absolutely absurd things. We even hear that he didn't know what he was talking about. He just says words for the sake of saying words. Now, I probably would have been in the same boat, probably have done much worse than he did in this respect. But think about what it is that he says and what it is he wants to do. This reveals, at least I think, two things that challenge us as the people of God. First, Peter thinks he must do something for Jesus. The Lord reveals himself in his majesty, and Peter says what? "Let's build some tabernacles. We'll build some tents." Now, why in the world is he trying to do anything? Does he want to add something to the work of Jesus? Does Peter think he can improve on what just happened? Unfortunately, that's something that characterizes you and me. Is there a sense in Peter where he's been seeing God revealed in his great glory, and it's such that it creates in him a very natural human response that says, "I have to do something"? The revelation of God in Christ is wonderful, but is it enough? Is there something I must do? Do I have to contribute to this in some way, small as it might be, in order for me to be a part of this marvelous community of God? We all fall into that. There are times when, and oh yes, we're Lutherans, we've learned the catechism, we know that we are saved by grace through faith, apart from works, so that no one can boast. We know that. But are there times in your life when you've wondered just a little bit, should I do something? Is there something I have to do in order for God to love me? I mean, I know my sins. I know what I've done. I know what I think. I know what I've said. I know what I have carried out. And the Lord knows these things too. Should I do something? And ponder that in terms of the things that aren't public and well known, but rather those things that God, who searches all hearts, already knows. That secret sin that you've never confessed to anybody else, but you hold inside. And you wonder, can God actually forgive that one? The Transfiguration says yes. The Lord reveals himself in his majesty and says, this is specifically why I came. I know all your sins. Nothing is hidden from me. I am God. And I know all that you've done, all that you've said, all that you've thought. I've known what it's been from your conception through your birth to the present time. And I know what you will continue to do out into the future. And it was for all of those sins that I came and I gave my life. They are taken away. They're gone. It really is finished. But on the other side of it, there's a second point, it seems to me. And that is simply this. When Peter says, is there something we can do? He's also trying to keep that moment. And can you blame him? You see Jesus in his majesty. This is what we'll see Jesus like when he comes again. We confess week in and week out that he will come again in his glory. Well, Peter and these guys saw it. And so they want to hold on to it. The glory. We'll stay here on the mountain. This will be where we remain. Have you had those mountaintop experiences in your life? And I'm not just talking about the championship by the Buckeyes last month. I'm talking about real mountaintop experiences. The real deal. When everything comes together in your life, those moments when it actually is all working. You know, maybe I shouldn't say moment, or that one moment in your life when everything seemed to be rightly ordered. And everything was working. When all of the problems went away, when all of the challenges had moved into the background, when everything was good. Do you remember that? Or is it too long ago now for you to recall? Or maybe it's right now. Whatever the case may be, we know what. It won't remain because we come off the mountain just as the Lord himself did. He had to come down from that mountain of glory in order to go to the other mountain where there was the cross. In our own lives as his people, he calls us to a life of service on behalf of our neighbor, our families, our children, which oftentimes are not mountaintop experiences. They are difficult. They are challenging. And sometimes it is outrightly painful simply to go from one day to the next. That's why he reveals himself here at this point, so that when we find ourselves in those challenges, we see what? Jesus only. The one who carries us, who bears us along in the midst of life's impossibilities. That is what he has come for. That is what he continues to do for you. In the end, it's about Jesus only. It is about Jesus dying for you so that your sins are taken away once and for all. It is about Jesus only rising for you so that you have the promise of everlasting life. Jesus only, in whom we live and breathe and have our being, rising and shining before the Father for all eternity. He says one last thing to us this morning, reminding us of what this text says, one last thing to us, reminding us then of what we are to do. And a cloud overshadowed them, and a voice came out of the cloud, "This is my beloved Son. Listen to him." Listen to him. Hear the voice of Jesus only. Yes, you have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. But more than that, Christ has carried your sins, fulfilled the law, and risen again so that you have eternal life. Listen to this gospel. Listen to your Lord Jesus. For in the end, For you, there is only one thing, that is Jesus only. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. And the peace of God that passes all understanding safeguards our hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus to life everlasting. Amen.